and someone who has a connection with outer space. That's why in the inner fold of astral skies, I asked Monica to paint a little spaceship, you know, which is in the inside. You remember the original? Yeah, it's in the inside, in the same color, but there's a little spacecraft in the inside. That's the one. Yes. So that's that story.
興味深いのはこのビヨンザストラズスカイズをレコーディングする前に実はイギリスのツアーをやっていまして、その時の映像がまあ今回のこのビデオにも映像にも入ってるんですけども、ツアーを行ったっていうのはどういう理由があったんですか？
The story was this. After I did the second Electric Sun album, which was Firewind, I just ran out of money because I had a court case with the Scorpions producer, and all my royalties were withdrawn. It was quite a simple question that he wanted to be my producer, and I didn't want a producer. I wanted to produce my own albums. So there were some contractual question marks. He thought that I was obligated to have him as a producer, and I thought I didn't have such obligation. But as the money went through him, he was able to stop the money for several years, so I wasn't able to do the third album. And then I thought to myself, maybe this is a good thing, because I felt I needed to have some time to find the new music anyway. I wanted to progress. So I stopped the band and I put it on hold in early 81. And then the next 2 years were very good for me because I wrote a lot of new music. And I found actually I was able to expand my musical horizons a lot. And then in early 83, I had a phone call from an English manager, Dave Cork, who said that he had some financial backers and he would like to do something for me and with me. And I said, okay, let's meet. And then he brought together a team of people, a very good team of people, and we were able to finance a really big tour in England and a smaller warm-up tour in Sweden. And this was possible because the first two Electric Sun albums had an enormous response in England. We had no record company in England. It was just on import. But I got hundreds of letters for these two albums and petitions of people, you know. I mean, in Newcastle, for instance, I had a petition with 600 people signing, please come to Newcastle. So we were actually able to do a headlining tour in England without a record deal, you know, and that was quite unusual. And that headlining tour went so well, that's the result there, that we then got a record deal with EMI. And that's how we did Astral Skies. And some of the pieces from Astral Skies are already on this video in a slightly embryonic version. Because when we did the album a year later, a year is a long time, and of course I was able to refine it. But for me, watching it back, it was quite an interesting experience because it showed me like songs like Why or What Is Love. We did them a little bit differently, and I really liked the result. So I was quite it was interesting for me to see what we did back then because I had forgotten all about it.
こういう当時の映像っていうのは、もうこういう後に、そのまあ記録として残そうということで、当時からこう、まめに撮られていたものなんですか？
No, no. It was all quite casual. I never thought about releasing it, except that this promo video was made for television use, but it was actually never shown. This is the first time. It's completely, all that stuff is completely unreleased. There are three sources there. The first is a promo video that we did in Amsterdam in 79, and that has three songs, and a fourth one, which is Lilac, which I edited from bits and pieces to start off the video. And I also gave it, I also reworked the sound of the album a little bit to make it sound more live. The second one is from a show in 1982 in Mulhouse in France called Moonlight Festival. It was a festival with many bands, Samson and quite a few others. And we were headlining on that festival. And this was actually the only show we played in 2 years. And it was the last ever Electric Sun three-piece show. Because in 83, which was half a year later, I didn't want to do the three-piece anymore because I really felt that my music demands harmonies, keyboards, you know, more vocals. That's why in 83 we had a much bigger lineup with 7 or 8 people on stage. And yes, so the second source is this Mulhouse Festival, and the third source is this tour in the spring of 83, which started off in Sweden, and then we did some shows in England. Birmingham Odeon, Newcastle City Hall, London Hammersmith, and Dunstable. And most of the material is from either Birmingham or Newcastle City Hall. But it was not recorded in a professional manner. It was recorded by one of our management team, just for reference, with a VHS. But that's why I thought I could never release this. But then some friends of mine, they looked into my cupboard and then they checked it out and they said, you should see this. This is really good, you know. So I said, no, I'm sure it's not good, you know. But they kept asking me for it. And in the end, I watched it and I was quite surprised because visual quality was quite good. And the sound quality was okay most of the time. So I said, well, maybe we can do something with it. Then I started working with it. And actually, I didn't want to do it. I gave it to someone else. But very soon, I realized that it was a very complicated job because there were about 20 hours of music. And so I started to think, well, if I wanted the result to be to my satisfaction, I'll have to do it myself. And that's when I started, and then it became a real headache because I realized that a lot of the sound sources were distorted and there was only one camera. And luckily, on the internet, I found someone who had bootleg recordings, sound recordings of all the London shows, of all the English shows. So they sent me all the bootleg recordings, sound recordings on DAT, on DAT. And then I had the second headache because they were all, the bootlegs were done originally on tape recorder and of course with bad batteries. So they were, the pitch was about a semitone up. It was running much faster, everything. But I've got a very clever sound system. So I had to time stretch the entire show. Every 15 seconds, one edit. And then I had a second microphone. And suddenly I was able to do stereo. I had two pretty bad mono sources, but together with my equipment, I was able to make a decent stereo. And then now I think the result is quite decent. Sometimes even very good, you know, but some of them are a little bit distorted. But I still left them in because I wanted to have a complete show of what it was back then. And this video actually represents a complete show from the beginning to the end.